Rob Legato, you've been a visual effects supervisor for a long time. When you first got offered the job on The Jungle Book, a live-action adaptation of a Disney animated classic, which is itself an adaptation of a beloved Rudyard Kipling novel, what went through your head? Did you think, how in the world am I going to do this?
Not really, because people have asked me that before. It's like it wasn't as daunting to me because technology has kind of grown up to that stage. It hasn't really been firmly put into effect, or the capability of it wasn't put into effect until you just literally choose to do it. The technology is there to do something that looks artificial and fantasy-like, but the same tool, much like a camera, could be used to photograph something that looks perfectly natural. And so I really wanted to do it. I like John very much, and we had a conversation about other things, and we have similar sensibilities about what looks real, what doesn't look real, and appreciate, you know, things that are done in camera or appear to be done in camera as the most realistic looking stuff. So we were sort of on the same page with that. And then I knew that, or felt that, the technology was up to speed to produce something that will fool your eye on a computer. And so in other movies that are totally done, like in this virtual world, usually are stylistic. They usually have, the skies are too rich and the colors are too rich. It kind of looks like a commercial, and it has a fantasy element to it. It doesn't look like a conventionally shot film. So I was very sort of charged up to use this vehicle, especially since so many people wanted to make the same movie. Alan Horn wanted to be a photoreal movie. John definitely wanted to be a photoreal movie. I certainly, if I was going to do it, wanted to be a photoreal movie. All of those various things were all in place. So me doing it and then being allowed to do what I started doing on Avatar, and I've used in fits and starts in other movies, was like, wow, okay, great. So you wanted to do the way I want to do it, and you want to, you know, give me all the support in the world to do it. It was like kind of a no-brainer and not terrifying. And we had some great people, Adam Valdez at NPC, Andy Jones and Dan Lemon and Weta, so we had, I had like an all-star team to work with to produce the best work that we could possibly do in the time frame and all that stuff without the usual limitations that you have from the studio. So it was like kind of a no-brainer, I would say, would be the best way to describe it.
Well, it certainly uses the full force of visual effects. So, you have a lot of work cut out for you, but I'm sure it was a lot of fun as well, trying to figure out how to create these animals that looked photoreal, but at the same time, they're talking animals, so they're going to.
Well, that was the scary part, quite frankly, is that, we picked a naturalism all the way through. The way the camera moves is naturalistic. It's born out of picking up a virtual camera and in an analog way, moving it around, making lens choices you would on a set, making camera move choices you would on a set, being moved by the drama of the moment. It influences how you would photograph it. Unlike what's done on a computer where you don't have the sound in front of you, you don't have all that stuff, you're doing stuff with keyframes, it's really hard to get the rhythm of, or the organic juice that you get by seeing something and reacting to it and all that stuff. So right off the bat, you're trying to make the most photorealistic movie you can. Then you don't want the animals to be, I can't even pronounce this word, anthropomorphized to the point where they don't look like it can really be that character. You really don't. Hey guys, it's hard to concentrate on you. I forgot what I was saying.
You didn't want the animals to be anthropomorphized to the point of, looking unrealistic or looking too.
Yeah, looking unrealistic or behaving unrealistically. So as soon as you do that, you now say, okay, I'm going to photograph it like it's a real movie, like the animal was really there. I'm going to make it move the way that is. And now the only thing is that separates it from it being totally real from being fake is the fact that it talks. And so how do you do that well? And if you use the analogy, well, a parrot talks. It's an animal. So how does it talk? And it's like, well, it doesn't have any kind of special human thing besides vocal cords to let that happen. So what if we just treated all the animals like they just have vocal cords and they could speak and not overemphasize it. Don't overemphasize every word, every consonant, every syllable. Don't overdo it. Just do it the way, you know, when you see, you know, any actor talk, some of the words are, you know, his mouth is moving. Some of the words don't. Some utterances don't necessarily see the lip sync of it all, because that's the way we speak. So the animals should speak the same way. So we sort of made a leap there where we hope that worked. We hope that by making it so throwaway that it actually achieved the goal that we wanted it to achieve. But you don't know, you know, this is hard about this sort of doing this kind of movie. You don't have, as you shoot, the shot done and you could see 15 minutes of cut film and say, yeah, it's working. You are banking the entire movie before you're starting to see that. So we did, in fact, pre-shoot it, but we didn't pre-shoot it with seeing the lip sync and all the other stuff. We did it to get where the characters were moving, what the scene was about, how the camera moves, how would we shoot the boy to put him into this scene that's later going to be photoreal, all that stuff. So we made a leap, and I think we proved correctly that was the way to do it. Is since everything is trying to be real, make that real too. If an animal could speak, this is the way he would talk. He wouldn't talk any other way. He's not built by nature to do anything other than what he's doing. And so we didn't, and we treated all that way. And that's a sensibility throughout the entire film.
Right. Now, were you using motion capture on the set to photograph these initial movements, or how did
No, it was all done. We did to block out where the animals would go, but not to inform their movement, other than in the shot it needs to walk from the tree and sit over here and do that, so we can construct photographically what the scene is and then hand it over to the animators to then get rid of our sort of stand-in versions and put in the what we'd call the real animals, which are the really high-tech, incredibly high-tech skeletons and muscular system and skin on top of that and hair on top of that and all the bells and whistles that make it look like a photoreal animal. We were doing like a game version of it to block out the scene and create the scene like you would in a live-action movie. You know, you have all the actors there and you point the camera and say, well, you're going to walk, sit at that desk, and then you're going to get up and go to the door, and you're going to sit over here on the couch, and you're going to do all these various things. And then they don't like that. Let's try it again. Let's put it over here. And you keep on exploring the scene until you get it to work. And then you say, okay, that's what I'm shooting. Well, we did that. And then we said, okay, what we just shot and what we just cut together, give it to the animators to then make and capitalize on the choices we already made in terms of where they're going to be. And then the human behavior, or not human behavior, but the drama behavior, going to be added later, or perfected, or you know, honed later.
And what did Jon Favreau give you as a director that helped guide you along and create these effects?
Well, one of them is as soon as you have the sensibility that what you're doing is what it wants to be, because, you know, many times it could be what you're going to produce is in conflict with what the director has in mind for the movie, and you're continually not battling, but you're continually rubbing up against. It's like, we did it this way because we thought this was good, but you like it personally, artistically that way. We were sort of in the same mode all the time, and so he was remarkably consistent in his eye for seeing something that's a falsehood, whether it's a performance, whether it's the way the shot looked, the way the shot was framed, that we went too far making it look too beautiful, so he continually, and then because he's an actor, which helped immensely. When we would get into, not, I wouldn't even say trouble, but, you know, many ways to go with a performance. Literally, we photographed John lip-syncing the words and feeling like King Louis or feeling like Blue. And so his mannerisms and the way he moved and the way he thought and looked and changed his eyeline direction and all the various things informed the animators, because he's performing it as an actor, interpreting the role. And that's invaluable, you know, because at that point, all the actors are essentially done. You know, like in a live movie, if you don't have that performance, the actors are gone. There's no actor to call on to reshoot and show you that. But because John's an actor, you have John do it. And he's an actor.
Absolutely. And now, did you do a lot of work in creating the environment of the jungle as well? I mean, it looks very seamless.
A lot of work was done. Yeah, I mean, we had the A-team on it, which was remarkable. A woman named Audrey Farrar, an NPC, was in charge of all the environments and things like that. But, you know, she, with the art director, Chris Glass, came up with the scenario or the scene that we're going to place it in. We pre-picked certain things in a very crude way, but then the perfection of it, you know, why those flowers go there and these, and to create randomness, very difficult. It could look very stilted very quickly unless you have an eye for what a real environment looks like, what a real shot looks like, what a real, you know, jungle at that particular time of day looks like, all those things. So what ends up happening is there's a giant soup that all that stuff goes into, and then you rearrange the deck chairs a little bit to get it to be consistent from shot to shot to shot. So I did more of that, but you know, the lucky thing for me is that what I was given was already working. It just needs to be ever so slightly massaged and the sun in the right spot, and maybe we, you know, do a little more of a push in here. So you now just adding, just like a good director works with a good actor, you don't manufacture their performance, they bring it to you, and then you just guide it, you know, to one side or the other, so it feels like it's the correct nuance for the movie. And an actor needs that because they're out there performing and doing it, and they need the little bit of the through line corralling. Actor doesn't manufacture someone's support, he just hires the best actor he can, and then is there to help guide. And ultimately, I mean, my job was very similar to that, where I had the best people and they created something that was already in the ballpark, was already looking decent. And all I have to do is start to steer it and give it this live action sensibility other than a computer sensibility, which is very easy to fall into when you have control over everything. Actually, the secret of this movie is relinquishing control over things, acting like it was done with a real camera. And I was lucky to get that on film, as opposed to I art directed every last little moment. You know, you want the randomness, you want the randomness of light, you want the randomness of what camera you would do, how you would operate it, all those things create or remove the uncanny valley from the process.
Absolutely. Well, for your work, you've won two Academy Awards, one for Hugo and one for Titanic. I wonder what that kind of recognition means for you in your career.
I think people still hire me for that. It's a little hard for me. I don't like to be very boastful about it, but it's very personally comforting to be appreciated for your... You go out on the limb every time you do this, and your sensibility is you have to pick whatever you're going to do way months in advance, and you hope you're right. And you know, because some of the things were right and I was awarded for it, it makes it easier for me when I say I think it should be like that to be believed and less of a fight. And that is what's really strong for my career. And you, as long as you don't make it go to your head and you're always doing the right thing, then your opportunity is 90% of this thing. And if you get the right opportunity and don't blow it, you tend to do a good job. And I've been, you know, I think having two Academy Awards gives me greater opportunities on quality movies to assist on and work on and add my particular bent on filmmaking on. So in that regard, it's a huge help. It's very personally satisfying. I mean, it's a very nice thing to even try to downplay that that's what you did. And it's I highly recommend it. If anybody wants to win Academy Award, I recommend going for it.
Rob Legato, thank you so much. Congratulations on the film, and thank you for taking the time to talk with us.
Oh, thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you.
See you. Take care.